But if at first you fail to see me, let me tell you just where I'm gonna be. I'll be thanking Christ, my Savior, for saving a wretch like me. But if you should read that CD before my you'd like to greet me when my race down here on earth, Lord, it's run. Just wait, for I'll soon be coming. All across so I'll take you down, dear loved one. Oh, just where you can wait for me. Don't streets of gold. Don't look by the walls of jasper, nor among the many sights untold. For I belong in and I
of Jesus. If you have your Bibles in 2 Corinthians, let me say, Brother David, we got this thing around here. If you come twice, we claim you. Brother Sam and the family, if you come twice, don't we claim them if they come twice? So you can take that any way you want to, but I'll tell you after church what it means. We're so good to have you with us again tonight. If you have your Bibles in 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5, very unpopular message tonight I will preach. It's about inventorying time. Inventorying time. He said, examine yourself whether you be in the faith. Prove your own self. Know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobate. Before the service began one Sunday morning in a church, a member said to the pastor, said, "Pastor, if you see me fall asleep this morning," — that ain't never good to say to a preacher — "while you're preaching," said, "don't take it personally. It's not that your sermon is boring, it's just that I was taking inventory all night long. I didn't get to go to bed until the wee hours of the morning. And by the time I went to bed, I had to get up again. And I came to realize how many mistakes that I made through the year. Some shelves were empty and others were full of goods that I had not sold." He said, "Apparently I had bought too much of one thing and should have bought more of the other." That would say. Then he asked the pastor, "What do you think about inventory?" He said, "It's the same way that every child of God ought to do every day of their lives. Examine yourself. The main purpose of inventory is to determine where a loss or a gain can be realized. We asked ourselves how our lives have influence on other people. We can learn from the looks of our past and our presence and even the plans of the future what we're going to need. But I want to talk about three things tonight. I want to look at the past." Charles Swindoll suggested that this exercise is like standing in front of a full-length mirror of memory. There's two ways to look at the past, and both of them have a great value in every one of our lives. First of all, he said, when you take inventory, you need to understand, first thing you need to do is count your blessings. You need to know. He said, second of all, you need to look at your health. You need to look at your safety. You need to remember the kind of friends that you have. And be thankful for your family. Turn to somebody and say, "I'm thankful for my family tonight." Would you do that? We need to be thankful for our marital needs that God has provided. We need to thank God for answered prayer. Brother Billy, you wouldn't be here tonight if God hadn't answered your prayer. Thank God he's getting the better. The last thing is spiritual progress. You see, when a person gets saved, they're not just to sit down and do nothing. I've always said that God saves a person on credit. Why? Because he expects that individual to work for him for the rest of their life. I don't find it a burden tonight to stand on this behind this pulpit and tell you I'm thankful for everything that I have. I can count my blessing. Brother Charles, God's been good to me. I got more to thank the Lord for than anybody, I feel like, Brother Milton, in the world. But there's one thing about it. I know when it's time to take inventory, when God's not doing what he ought to, maybe there's something you're not doing that you need to do. It's time for us to understand all these things that I've mentioned here tonight are a blessing from God. If you got all these things that God's done for you, why don't you throw your hands in the air and glorify him and thank him for what he's doing? Since inventory involves counting, this is very appropriate. that the value of counting, that we count our blessings. I sung that song Sunday. I got so much to thank Him for. I guess I had 20 people come out and say, "Preacher, that's my favorite song." But you know what? If you'd sit down and think about what you've done for God and what God's done for you, I wonder which one would outweigh the other. It ought to make us appreciate how well off we are. Be more generous. We can use these members in time to that we have difficult times. How many times has God come on the scene and blessed you, or blessed your family, or your children, or your grandchildren? How many times did you feel like you were down for the count, and all of a sudden the power of the Almighty God came down from the glory world, and you reached down and you looked around and you said, "What caused that?" And then you thought about it a little later. It must have been the Lord that passed by here, and I didn't know it. Well, then when we realize that, we need to throw our hands up and glorify God and say, "Lord, you've been here, and I didn't even know it, but I want to praise you for it. I want to thank you for it. I want to glory. I want to touch the hem of your garment, because I know you've done what I need." As the saying goes, those who ignore the past are doomed to repeat the same mistakes over, Brother Barry, and over again. However, don't look too long. If you do, you may fall prey to a gloomy disposition which Satan may use to destroy you. You know the reason I come to church? It's not to see you. I want to see you, and I appreciate looking at you. I appreciate all of you that come, but that's not why I come to church. I don't come because my wife tells me I got to come. I don't come because my grandchildren come here or my children come here. I don't come for that reason. Sister Maud, I come because I want to come and praise the Lord. This is where I can come and lift up the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I praise Him all through the week. I go down the road, praise Him. I get out of the car, praise Him. A lot of time. But I don't know, there's just something about it. With the saints of God, somebody know what I'm talking about? Say glory. It's just something about when the saints of God all gather in. Hallelujah. There's just something about it where the circulation of the power of the Almighty God is. Who are you talking to? I'm talking to every one of us. We need to take inventory and make sure God is what we're supposed to be in our lives. Amen. And if He's not, we need to stock up on some things that we need for our spiritual being. Jesus said that a certain man planted a fig tree. He dug about it, fertilized it, and he cared for it. He expected fruit from the tree. But year after year, fruit never come in. You know, I was thinking, I got a big old pecan tree in our yard at the house. I put fertilizer around that pecan tree every year. The little pecans is about the size the end of your finger. I said, well, Lord, this is the third year that I've done it. I said, why won't my pecan get big? And my wife, she's smarter than me. She said, maybe it's because that tree gives small pecans. I said, you mean to tell me I've been putting fertilizer around this tree, Brother Johnson, for 3 years. $7.98 a bag. Three bags. And now you tell me it's little bitty pecan. I said, well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. If I don't get big pecan trees this time, I'm going to cut it down. They ain't big enough to eat. The squirrels like them. And it's the same way it was in the case of this fig tree. The same way. He said that the man that was talking with him, finally the keeper said, I'm going to cut this tree down, even to the crumbles of the ground. The keeper interceded and said, hey, let's give it one more year. Just one more year. And then if it doesn't bear fruit, we'll cut it down. The man agreed to spare the tree for another year. Maybe you're like that tree. Once you had a great experience with the Lord. Once you had a great experience, but you promised to be faithful. And you promised to be faithful. And you promised to be fruitful. And you haven't done it. You know, I love to get up on Sundays and Sunday nights and Wednesday nights. I've asked the Lord many times, Lord, why do I have to preach these kind of messages? But I want to tell you, there's a lot of people that started out this way and they fail by the wayside. It's not he that starts out, but it's he that endureth unto the end. Somebody say glory. I said it's not he that starts out, but it's he that endureth unto the end. Brother and sister, we got some enduring to do if we're going to that place called heaven. If we're going to see that man by the name of Jesus, we got some enduring to do. If we're going to walk on the streets of gold, if we're going to see the walls of jasper, if we're going to see the spring of life, we got some enduring. And enduring means that may be some hard times, but one thing I know, he will never leave you. He will never forsake you. He'll stick up closer than a brother. Hallelujah. Second thing I want to talk about, when you take an inventory, you got to look at the present. A true spiritual inventory not only includes a look backward, but it also involves a careful examination of your present life. Oh, preacher. Now you done hit it now. I don't want to do that. In order to do this, two things must be considered. One, I don't want nobody to backslide on me tonight, is our attitude. He needs to. You can holler, I'm a Christian, and have a old nasty attitude, and I don't believe it. Attitude loses when you become a child of the King. See, we want to talk about being saved, and we want to talk about, well, I'm saved, but we never say I'm sanctified. Listen, folks, that sanctification will cause that attitude to become one where people will like you. Number two, our actions is our belief up to date. If it is, then we are going to pass the test. Inner attitude always determines outward performance. You will say amen or old man tonight, but I've got to preach this. Did you hear what I said? I said inner attitude. Always, if it's inside, it's going to come out. Come on, folks. Amen or on me. I'm preaching you the word. Inner attitude will cause people to be turned off when you talk about the love of God. And it always comes out. Determined outward performance. In other words, if it's in here, it's going to be out here too. And we got to be careful of that. The world, the Lord works from the inside out. So if you're not working out our salvation, then it's likely we don't have. Yeah, I'm losing them every little bit. We don't have any salvation. There's a way that seemeth right, but in the end, there's destruction. In Matthew 12 and 20, Jesus said, Who is not with me is against me. And who does not gather with me scatter. This is kind of preaching when you wake up in the morning. You can get up and you say, I feel good today about myself. I feel good because I know what it's going to take. Listen, I'm not one of these pastors that wants to pat you on the head and tell you what a good job you're doing. You're going to get your reward when you get to heaven. It's not my place to pat you on the head. It's my place to proclaim the word of the Lord Jesus Christ and let you know what it's going to take for you to get to heaven. Amen. To be with someone in this sense means to share the same values, the interests, and the concerns. For believers, it means that Jesus is the way of life, becomes ours. That the biblical definition is belief. One who can be for something and yet not for something else. For example, you can be for marriage, but yet you're single. Amen? You say, hey, I believe in marriage, but I'm not married. Don't mean you won't get married. Just believe you believe in marriage. You can cheer for your favorite teams and yet not be a part of them. Judas was for Jesus, but it was clear he wasn't for him. Come on, folks. Hallelujah. If one of the definitions of a Christian is to share in the concerns of Jesus, then we need to know who we are. Jesus said, I've come to seek and to save the lost. Evangelistic was a main concern of the Lord when he was here on this earth. And he's still concerned about it today. He wants to see people saved by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, one time a man looked at himself and at the self that Christ can really see. I mean, who you are is who he sees. Said, I saw the person I am today and the one I ought to be. I saw how little I really pray and how little I really do. I saw the influence of my life, how little it was. It was very true. I saw the bundles and the faults and the fears I ought to lay on the shelf. And I have given a little bit to God, but I have kept most of it for myself. I came from seeing myself with a mind made to be the sort of person that Christ could use with a heart he could never see me. Examine yourself. What is the condition of your heart? And I'm going to go to number three and I'm going to close. Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself. He'd not eat pork or drink or wine because they were forbidden by the Lord in the Old Testament. Now, if you don't want to eat it now, bring it to the parsonage. He defiled the king's order, but he didn't lose out. He earned the admiration and respect of the captors because he did what he felt led to do. He had conviction and he stood on what God had taught him. Jacob resolved to bring his title to the Lord at Bethel. He had a dream. Angels going up and down the ladder. When he awoke, he looked up to God and he said, if you go with me, I will live for you and surely give you 1/10 of all that I earn. I'm going to say that again. For all you that don't feel like you need to do that. Said when he awoke, he had a dream. He said, but when I woke, he looked up to God and he said, if you'll go with me. He's already told us he'd do that. Amen. I'll live for you and surely give you 1/10 of all that I should earn. He had nothing to call his own. When he made this vow, he didn't keep it faithfully, but when he did, God, he reaches a blessing upon him. Because he said what he would do. It's better to never make a vow than make one and break it unto the Lord. Amen. To be a man of prayer because he had inclined his ears to listen. Paul made a resolution to be a soul winner. What a marvelous thing for somebody to do. He said, every one of us would resolve to win one soul as Paul did. Just one soul. As you inventory your life, what plans do you have to change? Have you really looked at yourself to consider, what am I? What am I doing for the Lord? You might have been a Christian for a long time. You may have lived for God for 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 years. What are you doing for the Lord? Life is very short. You can live as long as you want. You know, somebody said the other day, was talking about somebody being old, Brother Ronnie. They were real old and they lived for the Lord all their life. I said, you know, you can't do wrong by doing right. God will take care of you, folks. We need to take inventory and see where we stand with the Lord. Come
to church is not enough. I know people go to church every Sunday morning and live like the devil on Friday and Saturday night. That ain't enough. You've got to commit yourself unto the Lord, and when you do, you've got to take inventory and see if you will God.
Right.
And if you will, the Lord will help you. Would you stand? With every head bowed and every eye closed. I never like to have any service without opening these altars. Have you took inventory of yourself lately? Have you really seen, Lord, have I been doing what you would have me to do? Am I really working for you the way I want to? Lord, I know it's day. The Bible said, work while it's day, because nighttime would come when no man could work. With every head bowed and every eye closed. I'm not going to call you out, and I'm not going to call you to this altar. But if you want to do more for God, I want you to lift your hand all over this building. Whether you're a saint of God or you're not, if you want to do more for God, I just want you to raise your hand. Hallelujah. In this closing prayer, Brother Taylor's coming, and he's going to pray for you that you'll do more than you've ever done before.
Father, as we come before you now, we just thank you for this word that's challenged our heart, that's reminded us, Lord God, of our purpose, Lord God, here upon this earth. And Father, I pray that you will just touch every heart and every spirit, Father. Help us, Lord God, to commit ourselves, Lord God, to being what you would have us to be, Father. To walk in where you would have us to walk, Lord God, and to accomplish the things that you would have each of us to accomplish in our life, Father. Lord God, help us to set aside everything that hinders us, Father, prevents us from being what you would have us to be, Father. And Lord God, to serve you in a very special way tonight. In Jesus Christ's precious name, amen.